Howdy, folks. Dr. Will Wong here. Welcome to tonight's edition of The Essentials of Life and Wellness. First off, tomorrow, as I record this, is the 10th of November, and I want to wish a happy 245th birthday to all my brothers in Marine Green. Also, the day after that is the 11th of November, and a happy Veterans Day to all who have served. And let's remember those folks who left the parade decks and never came back. I don't think I ever told this story, but there was one time on Parris Island, I pulled some extra duty, and I was sweeping and mopping out the morgue on Parris Island. I pulled a week with a casual company there. We were getting the overflow from Dover Air Force Base. Now, Dover is where all the bodies from the boys who died in Vietnam came back home to before they got sent out to wherever they came from and buried. We were catching the overflow, and it was the height of the Vietnam War. We were losing something in the line of 400 guys a week. And in between sweeping, swabbing the decks there and making everything ship-shape and squared away, it occurred to me that this was the first war where the boys actually got to come back home after they had passed away. That in all the other wars that we fought, the boys never came home. The parents never got closure. The family never got to see their loved one buried. Wives never got to weep over their husbands' coffins. That all those kids, and they were mostly kids in all of our wars, who have died in a faraway land, God knows what reasons. The First World War was an absolute sham. We were duped into that one by the Brits or by the bankers. And I'll put it to you that if we had gone into the first one, it would have ended in a stalemate, and the second one would have never have happened. The doughboys coming back from the First World War knew that we had been conned into the war. They were isolationists, which is where Lindbergh got his isolationism from. But I'm going off on a tangent here. Let me get back to what I was talking about. There are really beautiful burial grounds in France. There are really beautiful burial grounds in Belgium and Luxembourg and all those other places where our boys spilt their blood and died. There were some pretty ratty burial grounds in the South Pacific Islands like Tinian, Peleliu, Saipan. From what I understand, they've been cleaned up and they look a bit better now. They've even brought some of the bodies home. But those boys never made it back. And the sadness and the sorrow of those boys and their families lingered on till the last ones of their families died. Didn't realize when I was sweeping and swabbing that I was empathic. I was too young to know what empathy was. I didn't know what being empathic meant. But I could feel the energy that was in that morgue. It was dripping off the walls. It was all-encompassing. It was everywhere. And it was a very heavy, heavy sadness. An extreme sorrow that I pray to God I never get to experience again. And so I thank all the boys and girls who have ever put on an American uniform. From the Revolution to both sides in the Civil War to the War on Terror, I thank you all for your service. Whether you volunteered or got drafted, whether you were in combat arms or a Remington Raider, I thank you all for your energy, for the love and camaraderie you gave to your brothers and sisters, and for serving our country. God bless you all. And now let's go over some new data that Dr. Ron Rapice sent me on the benefits of coffee. All you folks know that I love coffee and recommend coffee as a health drink, much to the chagrin of the anti-coffee people, especially some of those crazed vegans. You know, they really need to eat some meat and get some blood in their veins instead of the water that flows through them and get their brains working right. But here, moderate coffee drinking reduces your chances of being hospitalized for arrhythmia. Coffee may trigger a 30% increase in blood flow to your small blood vessels, including those around your heart. One meta-analysis included data from 11 studies and nearly 480,000 people found that drinking coffee 2 to 6 times a day was associated with a lower risk of stroke. One study of 25,138 people found that those who drank a moderate amount of coffee lowered the prevalence of coronary atherosclerosis, that's hardening of the arteries. The chlorogenic acid in coffee protects the nerves, the neurons, from glutamate neurotoxicity, which suggests that it might be a benefit for neurodegenerative diseases such as an ischemic stroke, which is a dry stroke from a blood clot. Drinking 3 to 5 cups of coffee a day in middle age has been associated with a decreased risk of Alzheimer's and dementia in later life, which is exactly what the Hawaiian Men's Health Survey found. Among the people with mild cognitive impairment, those with higher blood levels of caffeine from drinking coffee were less likely to progress into full-blown dementia. Well, imagine that. The polyphenols found in coffee have anti-cancer properties, as demonstrated in a recent study of people with advanced metastatic colorectal cancer. Those who drank 2 or 3 cups of coffee each day had a lower risk of disease progression and death. Habitual tea drinkers lower their risk of atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease and all-cause mortality, had a 1.6-year longer life expectancy, and lived 1.4 years longer without atherosclerotic or cardiovascular disease. Now, at the bottom of the sheet were all the references to all the studies where all this stuff came from. And yep, all the folks who used to say that coffee was so terrible and bad for you, we'll let them die young. That way they won't annoy us for as long, right? Good. And now let's get to your questions. First one reads, "Hi, Dr. Wong. I noticed that a lot of NBA and NFL players aren't experiencing male pattern baldness. This is strange to me because I would have thought that since they were so bulky and muscular, they would be raging with testosterone and DHT and thus have male pattern baldness. I'm in my mid-20s already and starting to experience male pattern baldness. Do you think a lot of these pro athletes have great genetics that helps them keep and limit the amount of DHT in their bodies? And my answer is howdy. Doctors try to explain this, and this is where the 15 to 30 minutes they get in testosterone education in med school goes completely awry. Yes, DHT is an androgen, like testosterone is. But what is the DHT level of those men with high testosterone? The answer is very low. When a teenage boy has raging hormones, he also has a very low DHT rate. When he's got sky-high testosterone. When does DHT begin to increase in a man? The answer is when his total and free testosterone begin to drop and his estrogen begins to increase. In past generations, that happened between 40 and 45 for the boomers, 55 and 60 for the World War II generation. But as the famous strength coach Charles Poulquin, the late Charles Poulquin, said after training thousands of athletes from the 90s through recently, 31 is the new 50. Due to estrogen-rich foods, estrogen-rich environments, estrogen-rich plastics, food trays that released estrogen-like chemicals when they were warmed up, estrogen-rich agricultural chemicals which permeate our food, and due to the lean towards eating more vegetables and less meat, protein sources have been replaced with peas, pods, seeds, and beans, which are all a mini-uterus and all estrogenic. Now add to that the soy formula that boys may have gotten at 4 to 6 bottles a day. Each bottle of soy formula, depending on the brand, containing 3 to 8 birth control pills worth of estrogen per bottle. And since 1973, when soy formula was first released, we have generations of estrogen-fed men who never fully came into their manhood as their great-grandfathers, their grandfathers, and their fathers did. So, the answer to your question is, in vivo, in live humans, we only see high DHT levels in two sets of folks. Men with low testosterone and estrogen dominance, and men taking DHT-based anabolic steroid drugs like Dianabol and Winscrol. So lower your intake of the veggie proteins, the peas, the peans, the pods, the seeds. Remember, if it's a bean, a pea, a pod or a seed, it is a mini uterus and is estrogenic. This is why any vegan athlete that tells you that they did it all on veggies is lying to your face. Shamelessly lying. Because having worked with them, they were all on anabolic steroids. Look at the chart called Phytoestrogen Food Content at drwongsmessage.com and stay away from foods containing above 600 micrograms of estrogen. As a basis for comparison, the average birth control pill has 3 to 5 micrograms of estrogen. Get on the progesterone cream, aromatase inhibitors, and pro-testosterone supplements. They will work for you until your late 40s. Then you'll likely have to go on the medical testosterone. Get on the two minerals essential for making all hormones. If you want to use our supplements, the combo will be Karuna Pure Progesterone Cream, 1/8 to 1/4 teaspoon, apply daily to the skin. Synest, 2 capsules daily before bed. Andean Essence Max, 3 capsules twice daily. In Kindle, 2 capsules twice daily. Zinc citrate, 1 capsule of ours for 100 milligrams of elemental zinc. And magscorbate, 1 capsule twice a day. You can use minoxidil on your head daily to keep from losing your hair. And that's about it. Be well and God bless. Dr. Wong. And the next question reads, good morning, Dr. Wong. And he names this person's name. Would like to start taking the zymesin to begin addressing the scar tissue in her abdomen that is constricting some of her organ function. The question is it possible to take these rectally? If yes, what would be the best method to get them in there? How many per day and what time of the day? Thank you for taking the time to review this question and reply. And my answer is howdy. The only folks who are administered systemic enzymes rectally are unconscious head injury patients in German, Central and Eastern European ERs. If taken by mouth, the enzymes will get everywhere, and there is no need to put them close to where you want them to be for them to work. My suggestion is that she take 2 capsules, 3 times daily of the zymesins, and 1 capsule twice daily of the magscorbate. She should start feeling the release of the intra-abdominal post-operative scar tissue in 3 to 4 weeks, with most of it being gone in 8 to 16 weeks. She can then lower the dose to 3 capsules 3 times a day, but not go off them completely, as a physiologic rule with scar tissue is that it will want to regrow wherever it has already been. During the lysing of the scar tissue, she may feel nothing at all, or, as some gals describe, she may get a feeling like ants marching around inside. That's perfectly normal. Be well and God bless, Dr. Wong. And the next question is, dear Dr. Wong, hope you and the family are doing well. Thanks for the podcasts. I may have asked you this about a year ago, but I've had a bad lower back for 30 plus years now. And in the last 4 years or so, I've also started to hurt badly while sitting on my ischial tuberosity, both of them, when seated. I'm 56 years old now and have a lot of softness and lack of muscle in the buttock area. I've been doing glute strengthening for about a year now with little muscle growth, but 1-hour car rides or restaurant visits are very uncomfortable. I've had stem cell injections into both of the sit bones about 18 months ago without much improvement. Is it a lack of a muscle problem? Because thank God there's no pain when I stand or when I lay down flat. Do you have any suggestions to heal the pain? Thanks, as always, for your knowledge and for everything you do. Blessings to you and your wife. And my answer is, howdy. No, it's not really your back. And yes, having bigger glutes would help. But no lower back patients can build those because of the spinal stenosis that sets in after back injury. Back injury patients find that their injuries prevent muscle mass to be grown in the pelvis and lower extremities when even testosterone or anabolic steroids are used. You can try working them out, but as you found, you can get them stronger, but they don't get any bigger. And when not padded, then you get direct pressure on the sciatic nerves when you sit, and that just kills. I understand that, as I'm going through the same. I'm still leg pressing in the high 400s and low 5s. My stair climber is set for very high resistance to help grow muscle, etc., etc., etc. I get nice strength, but zilch in increased mass and size. Long drives are out, and sitting in restaurants kills. Had jury duty, and I had to bring my own little cushion to sit on. The everlasting comfort cushion is the one that I've settled on, using a slew of others, both foam and gel pads, and I sent him a link to Amazon.com and the everlasting comfort cushion. In June, I had to do long drives to pick up and deliver my older kids and grandkids from DFW Airport, which is almost a two-hour drive from where we live. During the drives, I experimented with one of the pulsed electromagnetic therapy devices I use from Earth Pulse for sleep and pain control. I set it running in the car via an AC to DC converter. I had one magnet under the cushion, and I set the unit to recover and to 100% intensity. Not only did it work to allay the pain I would have developed driving 2 hours there and 2 hours back, but my back felt better all day afterwards. So when not driving long distances, I've got the unit sitting in my recliner where it runs when I watch movies. I've also put another unit under my bed, and it helps me to sleep soundly and relieves pain. Again, that website is www.earthpulse.net. Lastly, since pain is neurological due to direct impingement and not due to inflammation, ask your doc for a prescription for gabapentin. It's a mushroom extract, a GABA derivative, and is specific to nerve pain. Now, gabapentin has also been found to help regrow brain tissue. So if you use it along with the lion's mane mushroom extract, you can use it as a brain booster. Try the gabapentin first at doses of 300 milligrams and under, as it may make you loopy. But in a day or two, you won't be. You'll be fine. And after you stop being loopy, then you can go back to things like driving and working heavy machinery. I have to say that while there are many things in the natural health world that claim to work on inflammation, there is nothing, zero, zilch, that works on nerve pain. And nothing works on nerve pain as well as gabapentin. Be well and God bless, Dr. Wong. And right now, a whole bunch of super purist natural folks out there who don't have any pain, who don't have any real suffering, who don't have anything wrong with them, are screaming at me, oh, but what about the use of such and such and such and such and such and such extract and this there herb and that herb? Go ahead. You get yourself into major instances of chronic pain. Go out and jump out of airplanes the way I did. Go out and have a few car wrecks the way I've had. Go out and have 5 cervical fractures, 1 unhealed thoracic fracture, 3 lumbar herniated discs, 2 compressed discs, spina bifida occulta, spondylolisthesis, all leading to spinal stenosis, and tell me that your herbs are working as well as gabapentin might. When you get to that point, most of you will give up and just frickin' go on the opiates. You won't even bother with the mushroom extracts. You'll just go straight to the heavy-duty stuff, proving what a damn hypocrite you are. Folks, always be wary of the super purists in the health food and natural health industry. They are the folks who criticize everything and everyone else. They are the folks who are always bragging about their diet. They have to tell you about their diet. They have to tell you that I'm a vegan, I'm a vegetarian, I'm a this, I'm a that. Their diet is their religion. They count what goes into their mouth, every single morsel, calculate every calorie. But when push comes to shove and they get their asses in real trouble, not the little piddly shit these petty folks usually complain about, but I mean real trouble, deep, deep, deep pain, They'll be the first ones to jump ship and go for the Oxycontin. They'll be the first ones to jump ship and beg the doc for the opiates. They'll want the morphine, the heroin, the whatever else. They'll go for the super radical back surgeries that might leave them paralyzed because of the false promise that it's going to take away their pain. These are the folks who are going to forget everything they ever thought they knew, everything they ever preached about natural health. And it's almost karma for them having bugged the rest of us so badly about the little bits of allopathy that we have to introduce into our natural health and natural lifestyles and natural medicine, because nothing else will work. We were taught in naturopathic school that for every disease in nature, there's a cure in nature. 40 years of practicing naturopathic, I can tell you that philosophy is wrong. Not entirely wrong. It's only like 5 to 8% wrong, but it's not entirely right either. Now, for those of you who are going to tell me that the THC oil, the pot oil, will take away all of my pains, you know, I've heard that that works for some folks. And just because so many folks, so many legitimate folks have started telling me that the pot oil helped their chronic pain, their super serious chronic pain, I find myself a non-THC CBD oil. Matter of fact, I found two of the leading brands. Now, I'm going to start thinking that I've got an allergy to all cannabinoids, not just THC. When I was younger, I smoked, I think, 7 joints in my entire teen and college life, and each time I went into 3 days of toxic psychosis. I was dissociated. I wasn't me for 3 solid days. I was somebody else. And I could tell that my personality had changed. When marijuana users now are showing up in emergency wards in Colorado and they show this dissociation, they are diagnosed with schizophrenia, which is a permanent diagnosis. They're never going to get rid of that one. Whereas toxic psychosis is almost not quite the same as schizophrenia, but it is a change in personality. But that's a temporary diagnosis lasting usually about 3 days. But since everyone has forgotten, medicine has entirely forgotten what it knew about marijuana back in the 60s and 70s, the docs are having to relearn, or not learn at all. But with the non-THC oil, this is my experience. I quote, having been experimenting with supposedly zero or near zero as they can get THC CBD oil, one eyedropper, once or twice a day, I'm about to quit taking the shit. Because so far, there has not been any relief of pain. There's just been a dissociation from the pain. Pain's still there. I can feel it. I don't care. Mental faculties are down. What would normally be immediately occurring to me takes a while to kick in. I'm getting somber as hell and getting dissociated from my body as if my soul is not fully seated in it, but I'm just floating slightly above it. My eyes are beginning to look soulless. Even Michelle, my wife, says she's never seen the gaze in my eyes that she sees in me now. And as it did when I tried smoking this crap in the early 70s, the stuff takes 3 days to metabolize and clear out of my body. Fine motor control needed for everything from aiming a cursor with a mouse to martial arts and shooting are all shot to hell. So much for the non-THC cannabinoids being harmless. If I take any more of this shit, I'll be acting dumbfounded like a frickin' dementia patient. And my commentary stopped there, except that it didn't take just 3 days to get rid of that stuff. I'd only taken it for 2 days. I took 2 doses the first day, 1 half dose the second day. Folks, the effects lasted me a full 23 days. It took 23 days for the dissociation to go away. It took 23 days before I could put a decent sentence together and go back to doing a show and writing. So as I said, it might just be me. I may just be allergic to all cannabinoids. I'm not getting the effects in pain decrease. I'm not getting the happy effects, the calming and whatever else that everyone else seems to get from using this crap. Pardon, that's my dog flapping around behind me. If you can hear that noise, I didn't get any benefits from the CBD oil. All I got were bad effects. And on that note, I wish you all God's blessings, be well, and I'll chat with you again next time. Bye-bye.
Thank you for joining Dr. Wong this evening for the Essentials of Life and Wellness. If you have any questions about this show, or if you want to ask Dr. Wong any health-related questions, you may email those questions to him directly at askdrwong@drwongsessentials.com. The products Dr. Wong recommends can be found online at drwongsessentials.com, or you can speak with a customer service representative at 866-268-3216. Dr. Wong also has an extensive natural health website written in Dr. Wong's unique and easy-to-understand style that discusses remedies for some of today's most debilitating and chronic conditions. Those are at drwong.us. Dr. Wong's lecture and podcast from 2007 through 2016 can be heard at drwongradio.com. His podcasts since 2016 and his lecture, Fighting the Things Most Likely to Kill Us, can be found on YouTube by searching for Dr. William Wong's Essentials of Life and Wellness. Until next time, we hope you have a safe and healthy week. Be well and God bless.